Professor Schein, you advocate for a new kind of leadership helping given the new challenges. What are new challenges do you see nowadays?
I think the reason why leaders will have to develop these new competencies, it's not a whole new type of leadership, but it's a new set of competencies, has to do with several factors that I see going on in the world. First of all, multiculturalism. More and more of leadership will be in a team context where the other members of the team and the subordinates will be from different occupations and from different cultures. And those occupations will themselves, factor number two, complexity. Every occupation is more complicated today, so the leader will be dependent on the subordinates for knowledge that the leader won't have himself. And then thirdly, information technology is creating a widespread difference in distance between leaders and their subordinates, potentially. The subordinates can be all over the world, and that will require the leaders to be able to elicit information, which will require a kind of ability to accept help from subordinates. And then finally, I see a trend toward companies having to become more socially responsible. Think about the environment more, which will require a different mindset where the leader will have to be paying more attention to get help from the community, to get help from government, so that the organization can fit itself into this new kind of a world.
What does that implicate for leadership?
I think it means, and this is why I entitled the book Helping, it means that the leader both has to be able to give help to the subordinates in the form of creating an environment where they will feel free to bring up information and be able to accept help, because the subordinates will be bringing information that will require a different attitude, a different set of decisions from the leader. Put that again into a team context, I think of a team as a group of people who are perpetually and mutually helping each other, all the time, perpetually, and therefore they have to have the skills of giving and receiving this kind of help, or the job won't get done properly.
Can you briefly just define again what is helping in your understanding?
Sure. Helping or help is giving someone the ability to do something that they cannot do for themselves. And in that definition, one can already see why helping is difficult. Because very often we try to help someone with something that they could do for themselves. And if we do that, we risk insulting them and making them feel less than they are, because when someone tells me to do something that I know how to do, I feel insulted, you know. You shouldn't have to tell me that. The best example I can think of comes with computer helpers. When I have finally learned from my coach how to do certain operations, very often I'm about to hit the return bar and the coach does it for me. He's so anxious to get the thing done fast that he hits the bar, and I feel like, you don't think I can do that for myself? So if you really think carefully about help is only when the other person needs it and can't do it, then you can also see why it's such a complicated process.
And taking up that thread, why helping is so complex? You alluded to it already. Can you say more on the complexity of helping?
one has to look at it both from the point of view of the client and from the helper. From the client's point of view, the complexity comes from the fact that to need help, to ask for help, makes one feel inferior in most cultures today. Being an adult means you don't need help. So if in fact I have to ask for help, I'm making myself vulnerable, because then the other person can give me wrong information, they can take advantage of me. So that's the complexity from the client point of view. From the helper point of view, the counterpart complexity is, if you ask me for help, and if I'm not careful, I may give you a lot of advice which isn't very helpful, because it may not be dealing with a real problem. Therefore, for me to be helpful to you, I really have to ask you some more questions and elicit what the real problem is before I can figure out how to be helpful. And this, when someone asks you a question and you quickly give an answer, that often turns out not to be helpful, because we haven't found out what does this person really need. We've made the assumption that the immediate question was what they really needed.
What different types of questions and interventions are there, and do you recommend?
I think of questions as coming in several categories. The most important one, and this is what I think leaders most need to learn, I call humble inquiry. Humble means I don't already know the answer. I really am allowing myself to be ignorant because I really need information. So you ask me for some help, the appropriate first response is, tell me more. Give me a little more information. What kind of help do you need? That's humble inquiry. The next layer of questions would be diagnostic questions. If I really understand what your problem is, I could then ask questions like, why do you think this is happening? What have you done about it? Have you thought of some alternatives that force you to think diagnostically about what you might do? But I still haven't told you what to do. I haven't given you an advice. So then the third level question, which I call confrontive questions, would be where I give you a content answer, where I say, well, here's what you should do. Or have you thought about doing this or that? Or if you've asked me for directions, I say you go 3 blocks this way and then 2 blocks that way. So when you're being asked for help, you should think about, at what level should I be responding? Humble inquiry, diagnostic, confrontive, because the consequences for the person who asked for help are very different depending on which level I choose.
And what role does trust in this relationship play?
I think when we ask for help, we are hoping that we can trust the person. If I ask you for directions, I'm hoping that you will give me the right directions, that you are not an evil person who will send me the wrong way. But I don't know for sure whether I in fact can trust you. So if I'm dealing with a more personal problem, I probably will not tell you immediately what the deeper problem is. I will float some more surface problem to test whether I can trust you or not. And if you are properly humble and you make me feel better, I trust you a little bit more, then I may reveal what's really on my mind. So building trust is essential to what I would call a helping relationship, where people then begin to be more open with each other and say, here's what's really worrying me, here's where I really need the help, and be able then to know that the other person will respond appropriately, will not take advantage of me. They won't say, oh, you stupid person, you shouldn't have that problem, and make me feel worse. Instead, they will take me seriously and let me try to solve the problem.
And there are some traps in helping as well. And how can both parties actually avoid those traps?
Well, the trap for the client, I've already alluded to. The trap is to ask the wrong question. And then if you get premature advice, to say, you know, that was bad help. But it was bad help partly because I asked the wrong question. Mm. So the trap for the client is to be careful what you ask. The biggest trap for the helper is to bypass the humble inquiry and to jump in too fast with premature advice or premature guidance as to what the client should do before you found out what the problem really is. Because help won't really occur until they both feel they can trust each other, and that requires building that relationship. Mm. It doesn't happen automatically.
Mm. And I know that your preoccupations are safety issues in high-hazard industries. So tell me, how are the safety and organizational effectiveness connected with each other?
Well, I have to then really go through a whole set of logics. Is that what you want me to do?
I'd love to.
All right. From working in the safety industry, I learned that the biggest problem is failure of communication. Mm-hmm. Subordinates know things that are going wrong, and they either choose not to tell their boss what's going wrong, or they have told him before, and the boss never paid attention, never did anything about it. So they decide the company doesn't care anyway. So the failure of communication creates an accident sooner or later. And then when we say, well, how do we fix this problem? We fix this problem by bosses creating a climate where subordinates will feel like telling the truth to their boss. That climate is a climate of mutual helping. In other words, the boss has to convey to the subordinate, we need your help. You know, we need to know what's really going on. And the subordinate has to feel, you know, when I come and tell you something, you will take it seriously and you will do something about it. So in order to fix the communication problem, you have to create a different kind of relationship between superiors and subordinates, and that relationship can best be characterized as a helping relationship. And then you look at organizational effectiveness and you realize it's the same principle. It doesn't just apply to safety. If you want an effective organization, you want relationships between bosses and their subordinates and team members where everyone will feel we can be open, we trust each other, and therefore they give better information and therefore decisions get to be better.